Okay, good morning, or actually precisely good afternoon, as it's at 12 p.m. I'd like to introduce our last speaker, Andrea Aime, who's going to talk about standing up a OSM clone with GeoServer and CSS.
Thank you. So my name is Andrea Aime, I work for GeoSolutions. I'm a GeoServer, the core developer, PSC member, also involved in GeoTools and a few other projects. Our company provides services around GeoServer, GeoNetwork, MapStore, GeoNode, and so on. So, what are we talking about today? We are talking about this. And you may say, what? The GeoServer homepage? No, wait. Let's zoom in a bit more. OpenStreetMap. Well, yeah, but if you look at the bottom, it says rendering GeoSolutions data from OpenStreetMap. So, it seems like you're looking at OpenStreetMap.org, but instead, it's being rendered by GeoServer. So all the tiles that come from that page are not coming from OpenStreetMap.org, but from this WMTS, which is public, of course, at that capabilities URL. So what's behind it? How did we get an OSM clone going with GeoServer? Well, we get the data, the raw data from OpenStreetMap. We use Imposon Tree to turn it into a PostGIS database. Then we use GeoQuest and GeoServer to render it and cache it. And we use the GeoCSS language to prepare the styles, because the styles are big. So, motivation and history for it. There were several attempts online to render OpenStreetMap-like maps with GeoServer. One successful one, which has been abandoned, is OSM in a box. Then there's OSM GeoServer styles from MELP server. There was the Boundless OSM repository. You can all go and have a look at them. Why did I start a new attempt? Well, the previous attempt either went unmaintained, were not really a match to OpenStreetMap.org cartography rendering, and we're not using GeoCSS, and I'm the GeoCSS maintainer of the language. I wanted something that would push the language forward. But more importantly, as the man said, we choose to clone OSM not because it's easy, but because it's hard. Going beyond the comfort zone is always a good teaching experience. OSM is interesting in a variety of ways. The dataset is huge, there is a lot of details, the style is complicated. No, it's not complicated. It's a veritable monster. It's a dragon. And working on it brought us several improvements to GeoServer which are not specific to rendering OSM, but are useful for everybody else. So, timeline. I started in this repository, which is public, you can go to it, in 2017, in my own spare time, and went for a number of months making improvements, and I'm not going to list them. They are in the slides, but I'm going to list them now because we are going to see them one by one in a minute. Then GeoSolutions picked it up for a job, and we made a bunch of other performance improvements, which are also going to see. This repository you can look up, but it's private, so no joy there. And then in this year, we made a bunch of other improvements. And yeah, the repository is still that private one. So, first of all, choosing the right style. When you look at OSM, the style that you look at, the map rendering that you look at, is called OSM Bright. There are many OSM Bright sort of clones or things called OSM Bright on the network, but there is only one that actually renders like OpenStreetMap.org, and it's at that URL, gravitystorm/OpenStreetMap.Carto. It's a Carto CSS style sheet which is going to get rendered by MapNIC. There are other options around, like the Mapbox OSM Bright and the OpenMap Tiles OSM Bright GL style. They are loosely based on the official style, but they have different rendering choices and much simpler maps. Let's have a look. So this is a side-by-side comparison. Official OSM in the middle, the Mapbox rendering is at the top, the OpenMap Tiles rendering is at the bottom. What you can see is that, well, there are obvious color differences, but what really stands out is the amount of detail that the other two maps lack. If you want to have more confirmation, let's have a look at this area that you by now know very well. And one is rendered by OpenMap Tiles and the other by OSM. As you can see, there is much less information in the Open Map Tiles rendering rather than in the official OSM. So what I see personally is different objectives. OpenStreetMap.org tries to represent as many details as possible. It tries to make an atlas of sorts. Mapbox and Open Map Tiles are sort of trying to go towards a base map instead, on which you can add overlays. And of course, they cannot clutter the map with all possible information because you have to add your own on top. So the only note that I have, it would be less confusing if they were not all called OSM Bright. Consequences of doing simpler maps is that you have to load so much less data, you have a simpler style that renders so much faster. And I could have done that, gone that way, but the objective was to do it because it's hard, so I kept the official style instead. Challenges. Doing it was really challenging, but it brought a number of benefits to GeoServer. The approach was to take the default Imposon 3 export, adapt it a bit, and then manually translate from Carto CSS to GeoCSS and fix any hiccup found along the road. And I found many, and I'm going to talk about them. First, zoom versus scale. Carto CSS is based on the zoom levels of WebMercator. So if you look at the style sheet, it says stuff like, if zoom is greater or equal than 12, than 13, than 15, and blah, 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 then use a different line width. They are basically changing the line width based on the zoom level. It's nice and useful if you only care about WebMercator, but what if you are targeting a different projection? And one of the reasons to do this work was actually doing OSM in whatever projection I want. Also, GeoCSS in GeoServer uses scale denominators, not zoom levels. So I could have just translated the zoom level to the exact scale denominator, which is that bizarre number, but it would have meant that any slight change in the scale denominator would have resulted in a different map, which was meant for the next zoom level. And I didn't want it. I wanted the scale denominators close to the zoom level to render like the zoom level. So I actually did the mid-cut between the scale denominators and then turned it into a round number that was easy to enter. And I ended up with this set of scale denominators, which are more or less the same. They are actually not that bad. So 400 million, 200 million, 100 million, 50 million, 25 million, and so on until the end. So moving on, I was typing the styles. And even if GeoCSS is more compact than Carto CSS, as you can see by the comparison of the road style in Carto CSS, which is the AMSS file, and the CSS file, which is the GeoCSS, we are 38 kilobytes versus 123 kilobytes, so it's significantly smaller. But still, the GeoServer style editor was like too tiny. It could not work in it. So we added to GeoServer a side-by-side full screen editor that would allow me and everybody else, actually, to work with a larger view of the style sheet. And we also added code completion into it while we were at it. So one benefit for everybody. Another thing was the scale dependency verbosity. In OSM Bright, loads of Z-level to road width association. There are a ton of them, and you've seen them in the table that I shared before. I could have done the same with GeoCSS, so SD less than 400,000, SD less than 200,000, where SD is the scale denominator variable. But it would have been pretty verbose. So instead, I used the categorize function, which is already part of SLD and CSS, and made SD the variable on which I'm classifying stuff, so that I can build a little table. If it's less than 50K, use 9. If it's less than 100K, use 7, and so on and so on. So pretty compact association between scale denominators and widths, which was a lot less typing. Another issue that I found was that Carto CSS for OSM Bright uses a lot of little SVGs, and GeoServer supports SVGs, but it renders them as they are, with their colors, with their strokes, with their appearance. In Carto CSS, they are used as shapes, as scalable shapes that you can color whatever you want. That wasn't supported. It got added. So right now in GeoServer, you can use an SVG as a well-known mark and then decide what color to use to fill them, stroke them, and whatnot. Then we started fighting against dragons. These CSS style sheets are really, really big, and they have to translate it down to SLD. They get translated to an in-memory object model that GeoTools uses, which is basically one-to-one to SLD. So, and I can actually save it as SLD. The problem is that CSS has cascading. Cascading is this notion that the rules interact with each other and a more selective rule overrides some properties of the more general rule. When you have thousands of rules in your CSS file, the combination of creating the combination of all and deciding which combinations are actually matching features takes a lot of time, too much time. So step one was to run a profiler and make it faster. I made the translation 10 times faster. And for many styles, that was enough. Unfortunately, for some, it was still too much time. Like, it took like a minute to translate the roads down to SLD. So realization, Carto CSS does not really have cascading. It has rule nesting, but no notion of cascading like in the web. All the rules are already designed to be exclusive with each other. So why bother to try to mix them? I added a new translation mode, which is called flat, which also helps a bunch of people who don't really like the notion of cascading. They would like a light syntax for an SLD-like behavior. So we went with this new translation mode for the larger styles, amenities, and roads, which were well above 1,000 lines. And that made the translation much faster. And also, the generated SLD got smaller. So the 38 kilobytes road CSS translate to just 1 megabyte of SLD. It was like 36 megabytes before. So quite an improvement. Then we found, oh yeah, the map is nice, but it's still really slow to render. And you might say, well, dude, this was meant to be tile cached, not to render on the fly. So what did you expect? I expected more, so I started working on it. One thing is that Imposum generates some these pre-generalized tables in which you have an overview of the roads with the less points in the geometries, started leveraging them with the pre-generalized data store. In that store, you can basically say, between this zoom level or scale denominator and that scale denominator, use this table. And in that other range, use another table, and so on. So you can go and use more and more simplified geometries. That was a win, but that wasn't enough. So I needed eyes on the target. What is slowing down my map rendering? I used Java Mission Control, started profiling session, loading GeoServer with map generation, and found out that there was no single place taking most of the time. It was a bunch of things. So one thing that was killing performance was using SSL communicating to the database. Encryption and decryption of the data was killing performance. So I added the ability to shut down SSL, which is quite kind of useful if your database is in a local network which is well protected and blah, blah, blah. Then found out that WKB decoding and transfer was slow. So we switched to tiny WKB instead, which is a well-known specification. Then we found out that there was base 64 encoding and decoding of binary data from the database and backwards. We enabled full binary transfer. Then the evaluation of rules in memory was slow because there were so many. It's unusual to have so many rules. So I added a way to rewrite filters in memory to make the execution faster. And finally, PNG encoding of the tiles was a bottleneck. We also improved that one. And here we are. Now the map is fast enough and high at high and low zoom levels. We still need to improve mid levels. They are much better than before, but some maps at 1 to 100,000 and 1 to 200,000 might still take 20, 30 seconds to render, which is way too much, in my opinion, and I need to go and fix it. However, I basically already optimize whatever I could in GeoServer, I have to move my attention to the database. There are attributes in the database that we are not using. I have to get rid of them. So basically, I have to modify the Imposum map file to get less data. The overviews tables are containing roads that we are actually not rendering. So I have to get rid of them. And I have to study a bit PostgreSQL a bit more to tune it for large, very large data sets. PostgreSQL typically comes with a very simple configuration that would make it run on a Pentium 4. And well, I probably need to tune it to use a more modern execution environment. And that's it. Or is it? Didn't I forget anything? Can anybody tell me what I forgot? That we didn't manage to do because, so I have this contract to read Mapbox vector tiles and render them in WMS, yes, but I'm gonna start working on it as I come back to work in a couple of weeks. So no, that's not the thing that I forgot. That's another thing that I forgot. Ah, the styles. I spent all this time talking to you about the OSM styles. Did anybody wonder where they are? So this is an open repository where I dumped all the styles and the imposem file. It's not a complete GeoServer directory yet. I have to work a bit on it because the closed repository that we have has lots of other layers that I need to clean out. But at the time being, you can go there. It's already open. It has all the CSS styles, the imposem file, and the pre-generalized data store configuration. And remember to use GeoServer 2.16 with them because all of these improvements that we made, well, some of them started landing a couple of years ago, but many of the improvements that we did in 2019 are available only in GeoServer 2.16, which is to be released in a couple of weeks. And that's actually all.
So that went quickly, very interesting. So we have a little extra time for questions, so please bring them.
Nice presentation. I'm wondering, the official style is updated quite often. How will you handle the updating of the style?
I didn't. Okay. The objective of the exercise was to make one version of OSM up and running, and there is no automated translation from one to the other. So they would have to be manually updated. Yep. And the repository is open. We accept pull requests and the like, so if people want to start working on it and help us keeping it up to date, that would be appreciated.
Hi, Andrea. Great presentation. Just one question. When you're doing the performance analysis, what were you, you're probably using WMS to get to generate the map, but what CRS, what coordinate reference system?
I was using WebMercator, but reprojection of vector data is normally not a significant overhead. So it's not like if I used another CRS, it would have been different.
Because I'm putting it in conjunction with a presentation yesterday that you had with the APH, and if you're asking it in like polar stereographic or something, wouldn't that bring even more higher load times for the map?
It will have some overhead, but as I said, the APH overhead is or should not be that visible, especially with maps that takes still a few seconds to render. I would expect it to become an important part of the response time when we go sub-second. But we are not there yet.
Thank you. How big is the database that you are rendering?
At the moment, all right. Oh no, you can see it, then I can. At the moment we are rendering Europe, the entire Europe. We are not yet ready to go full planet, mostly because of the reason that I said before about having yet to do work on the database. So before I try to import the whole planet, I want to make sure that I imported the minimum amount of information possible to get it going. there is another question there.
Just how big is the GeoServer instance that you're using to test?
I think that right now it's an 8-core with 64 gigabytes of memory split into 3 Docker images.
Okay, thanks.
Running concurrently all on the same machine. But as I said, right now most of the time is not spent on the CPU. It's actually the Postgres struggling to find the data for rendering. So if we go to whatever place, this map is rendering off the WMTS, so you might say, well, it's cached. True, but we didn't precede anything. So if I go to an area that I was likely not visited by anyone else, you can actually see the true rendering speed, which is this one. Right? So at this zoom level, rendering speed, even if stuff is not cached, is quite acceptable in my opinion, even also considering there is just one machine behind it. It's at around this zoom level that sometimes it takes a lot of time, but it's really database driven because I go to a place that I haven't visited before using the WMS directly, and it takes maybe 40 seconds to load, and then I pan a bit and the map comes back in 1 second. So it's really the database struggling to find data, and I need to find better ways to organize the data in the database. I don't think that there is any significant further work to be done in GeoServer until I fix up the database. Any other question? If not, please go on the website that I pointed you at, download the styles and play with them and have fun.